We have a government which is run by slogans. It's advised by political campaigners. They try to manipulate the news. They manipulate the message. They've manipulated the press conferences. They seem to have had willing collaborators in many of the mainstream reporters who've gone along with this, colluded with having only certain reporters invited to the press conferences, in having pre-selected questions, in not following up to forensically get the answer to the question. So we've had all this sort of orchestrated, top-down, almost totalitarian kind of approach to national life. And they seem to have built up a head of steam last week about opening up the country economically with scant regard for personal safety of workers. And then, lo and behold, this great mass of the public say, hold on a minute, it's us you're talking about. We're not happy with this. The trade unions always have the slogan, which has been so powerful in the labour movement over many decades, the people united will never be defeated. And here we had the people voiced through YouGov and opinion polls at the end of last week saying, hang on a minute, you're trying to do this? Are you serious? We're not up for this. And I think the people's voice is coming through. I think at this stage in this crisis, 3 months in, today will be the first time that the Prime Minister has addressed the Commons on the COVID crisis. First time in 3 months. The number of appearances he's made in the House of Commons is very few since he became Prime Minister. He really prefers to tee up a large television audience, a bit like President Trump does with his way of operating, showing a lack of respect to the House of Commons, a lack of respect to all the other members of Parliament. We are seeing the Conservative knives coming out now. I wouldn't want to predict how long this is going to last and what will happen next, but I will be surprised if he endures for a full term as Prime Minister. I think what will happen is, I think hatred's probably not the emotion that people are likely to feel for Johnson in the end. It may be more like ridicule and despising, these kind of words, that this was a man who was always a buffoon, always tried to make a joke out of everything. And to do that, to have that style in the middle of the biggest crisis for 100 years, is just so inappropriate. And I suspect that that particular penny is dropping with him too. And how he can escape from this shambles, this mess, with any saving of face will be something which is now challenging him and his party, who will be looking for a way out and beginning to think about who could they possibly draft in who could retrieve the situation for the immediate crisis and for the medium and long term for the Conservative Party. The inconsistencies of the government's and the media as well throughout this will be something that people will dwell on afterwards when we look back on this. You know, when the pandemic was getting into its stride here in England, the Secretary of State for Communities and Local Government wrote to all local authorities giving them details about how to organise street parties for VE Day. Now, it was already clear that we were going to be in a bad situation by May, and the Secretary of State for Communities and Local Government was encouraging local authorities to organise street parties. So we've had all of this kind of thing going on as a strand throughout this. We've had people encouraged to get out and social distance but celebrate, and then we've had the contradictory messages about whether you can go to the park and what you can do and what you can't do. We've had the media slagging people off at the same time as virtually encouraging them by pronouncing that we were going to move towards easing off the lockdown, and the government issuing contradictory statements last week about that. So they really prepared the confusion for the Prime Minister to step up to the mark last night and hit some sixes of confusion right out of the cricket ground. Let's go and cause complete confusion. There was a sketch that used to be on Monty Python called Confuse a Cat, where the idea was to see how confused you could make a cat. And you couldn't have done more of a Confuse a Cat sketch than the Prime Minister managed to do last night on his broadcast to the nation. It's quite clear that with the Prime Minister's speech to the nation last night, he's managed to confuse just about everybody in the country. People have no idea what is happening, what's supposed to happen today or going forward. It's just mind-blowing how confusing it's been. So we've got government by slogan, total confusion. The idea of easing off, and certainly in the way that he's spoken about, which seems to make it okay for better off people, people who are mobile, to go off into the countryside, but goodness knows what's supposed to happen to people who are stuck in tower blocks and working people who've got to try and go to work but not use transport. It's very confused for them. And he's left it in the hands of people again. He hasn't provided the clarity and direction so that people know where they stand, and at the same time proposing increased fines for people who get it wrong. So judging by the storm on social media overnight and by the media this morning, the newspapers and radio and television, he's managed to alienate a lot of people. I think the political aspects of this are now coming very much into the fore, you know, and they must do. But so here we have a political storm, but we must not forget that the essence here is we've got to sort out the testing and we've got to sort out the personal safety with the personal protective equipment. Until we got those two things sorted out, any talk of easing up is just nonsense. Well, in this national emergency, we were all called upon to work together for the common good. And it's become clear as it's developed that although everybody's been expected to sacrifice equally, the sacrifice hasn't been the same. I mean, we've seen what's happened to health workers. We've seen what's happened to Black and ethnic minority health workers being more at risk than others. And we're now seeing that bus drivers are at higher risk even than health workers. So that's been the case until now. But going forwards, it looks as though the burden will not fall equally, that people who are able to work from home will be able to carry on working from home in the comfort of their domestic environment. Others are being told that they really need to be struggling somehow or other to get to the workplace. There's no guarantee that these workplaces have now been safety proofed. The trade unions are very concerned about that. And actually, as well, we've had employers this morning, the employers' organisations, telling other employers that really they shouldn't be opening up for business until they've got much more certainty about what the rules are for looking after their workers. So it's really a dog's breakfast, and it's going to hit hardest on those least able to cope with it. I've always told everybody in my family and my teams, wherever I've worked and whenever I've led teams, it's so important to be a member of the union. And, you know, I would say that again this morning, particularly in these circumstances. If your union membership's lapsed or if you haven't joined a union, just get that sorted out now, because it's so important to have that collective voice and support when you're being picked off in this way. I don't think herd immunity has ever gone away in all of this. It's been lurking in the background as a fallback position for a failure to get to grips with this, to do the testing and to control it. We had late lockdown, and now we've got all this talk about easing off of the lockdown. God knows how that's supposed to make things better. We've seen that we've still got the virus circulating in the community. We're still getting quite large numbers of new cases every day. The curve of the deaths has not come down as steeply as in other countries that have got on top of things. And we've still got the real prospect of the virus leaking out from hospital environments with hospital staff, from care home environments with care home staff, from prison environments with prison staff. And that all of these things could reignite the pandemic here at home among that population that hasn't got resistance. And we think that probably still a relatively small proportion of the population has got immunity, having been exposed to it. But we don't know. We just don't know because we haven't been doing the testing. I think looking at the political side of this, we're in uncharted territory here. We have a government that's got a big majority, but the Conservative Party as a party has always had a very strong instinct for survival. And if, as seems highly likely, the Prime Minister has now begun to alienate not just the Labour voters who turned camp in the election, but also the natural constituency of the Conservative Party, which tends to be older people, and many employers and people who really want certainty so they can carry on and get back to work. I don't know what will happen here, but it begins to look as though some of the rumours over the weekend about the 1922 committee meeting and having views about the future of the Prime Minister, you know, they can be quite ruthless when they decide that the person who they've chosen isn't doing what they were expecting them to do. And I can imagine we'll see developments on that front before too long. But my concern is still with getting this right from a public health point of view. And the news that 50,000 corona tests were sent by aeroplane to the United States over the weekend for the laboratory side of it to be done there because our labs can't do it. And apparently two of the new labs here are not doing what they were supposed to do. So we're really far off from where we need to be, not just doing 100,000 tests actually delivered every day, but hundreds of thousands being delivered every day. And the Prime Minister acknowledged that in his speech last night, that we really need to be doing many. So in order to move towards an eased situation, they've got to sort this out. I mean, the sheer incompetence of Public Health England and of our national agencies to sort that out defies belief. And the personal protective equipment story just rumbles on. I mean, we had the Turkish consignment of gear arriving and not being fit for purpose. You know, we really have got to sort these things out, and we can't move on until we have. Here we have government by slogan. This idea about how slogans can do the business to move on from stay home to stay alert. So confusing what an alert is. And slogans have a point, they have a purpose, but you have to fill out the detail. If you want people to know what it is they've really got to do, once you've got their attention with a slogan, that's what the slogan's for, you then have to get across the message properly. So we had the red and the yellow for telling us to stay at home and look after the NHS and save lives. But then we moved on to this green and orange. Green, as we're all familiar with from the traffic lights, means go. So here we're being told, go, no, stop, no, no, prepare to go. No, no, prepare to stop. Oh, what actually? We're not quite sure what we mean, but we'll tell you tomorrow afternoon in the House of Commons, and we'll publish 50 pages for people to read, and then you can take it home and look at it in your own time. Come on, this is the 21st century. We've got the most modern communication system in the world. Let's have good comms here so that people know exactly what's going on. It just goes back to the fact we haven't had openness, we haven't had transparency, the public haven't been treated like adults from the very beginning, and we need a conversation in which everybody is included so that the conclusions can be followed through with support. Well, I think what we've seen here with both Wales and Scotland saying, I'm sorry, we are separate jurisdictions here. We'll make our own mind. You know, we're fed up with being dragged along, kicking and screaming by this crowd in London who don't know what they're talking about. We will go our own way. And good luck to the Scots and the Welsh, because I think we'll now see, as they diverge from the English situation, we'll have a natural experiment going on there to see whether they have more success than we have in England with this continuing shambles of a response. I think the issue of trust is at the very heart of this, and has been with it from the very beginning. The government made a big issue about trust after the Brexit referendum. They were saying 51% voted to leave, 49% voted to stay, the majority's to leave. We must keep trust with the public. We must leave the European Union. Trust, trust, trust was what they were preaching. And yet, from the very beginning of this, the way in which you build trust is by being open, by being transparent, by being honest, by sharing, and they didn't do that. And what they've done is they've consumed the reservoir of trust, such as it was for the government. They've just consumed it with all these mistakes that have been made, mistakes with not stopping people coming into the country without being screened and tested, mistakes about not ordering personal protective equipment without stepping up the testing capacity, mistakes with the way they've reported, or was it misleading to just report on the hospital deaths and not the other deaths. All along, there have been things said, things not said, which have undermined the trust. So when it comes now to the crunch, and when people are chewing at the bit to get a bit more freedom, then it's so difficult. And once you take the lid off the jar, the genie out of the bottle, and people start breaking the rules, getting that back again is going to be very, very difficult. I think this is a real crisis now within the crisis, because we do face not so much a second wave as a continuation of the first wave, and maybe an exacerbation of the first wave, at the same time that people have stopped trusting the messages from government. And we really need to come together under some kind of competent leadership to move into this next phase, which is going to go on for some months yet. It's such a contradiction that we had this Brexit campaign that was about taking back control of our borders, and yet we're the only country in the world, more or less, that's allowed people to come and go without being screened and tested. And we're now talking about implementing something very, very late in the day, you know, closing the stable door when the horse is gone. This is not just one horse, it's a whole grand national of horses that has left this particular stable. We had the virus coming back from the skiers in Italy and Austria after half term. We've had millions of people coming into the country from high incidence areas ever since. And if you ask why haven't we been doing that, then we know from the admission from the Deputy Chief Medical Officer Jenny Harris last week that the reason why we stopped testing and contact tracing was because we didn't have the capacity, and we'd allowed that capacity in our public health teams around the country to be run down, and we've somehow got to get that back. Other countries, places I'm familiar with, Bahrain, which has done very well. Everybody coming into Bahrain through the airport's been tested, and they've had test results back within a matter of hours. And here we hear stories of people waiting days or even more than a week to get a test result when they can even get a test. So, you know, this is the country that was going to break free of the shackles of Europe and take on the world. And we can't even sort out a proper testing system or properly equip our frontline health workers with safety clothing. When we talk about this difficulty of getting tests, the news is now out about the Premiership football teams, that the intention is to restart the Premier League soon, and that all the players are going to have regular tests. So I'm not happy about this. I think that if it's possible for Premiership footballers to jump the queue for tests, I think that undermines the solidarity of the country as a whole. And I don't think they should be able to do that until everybody who needs to have tests gets the tests. And that particularly starting with frontline health workers who are still not being tested, to think that we're prepared to see, to countenance our footballers getting tests before frontline health workers. I think, what has this country come to? We talk in this country about evidence-based policy. This is politically based science that we've had here. Politically based science, not science-based policy. Harold Wilson said a week is a long time in politics. A week is an enormously long time in a COVID pandemic. And it's less than a week now since the news broke about Neil Ferguson and his domestic arrangements, the sexual peccadillo, if you wish. But what was happening here seems to be transparently that Ferguson was being hung out to dry last Tuesday to distract attention from the death figures and the death tally exceeding all but Italy in Europe. And then since then, it's gone past Italy. So I think we've seen this playoff between the politicians and the scientific advisors. It was always on the cards that the politicians were lining up the scientific advisors to become the stooges, to be blamed if things went wrong. And it looks as though that's what's now happened. And since then, all the scientific advisors have been trying to distance themselves from the government. And some of the really misguided things that they did earlier on of giving comfort to the politicians, constantly going on about, we're following the science, we're following the science. I think they were flattered by that. They went along with that. Some of them may have had if not stars in their eyes, the vision of knighthoods and dameships and other kinds of civic honours in their eyes as they went along with us. And now as they've reached this point, well, we've reached a tipping point. People are now busy distancing themselves from the positions they'd got themselves into. I was contacted over the weekend by Professor Lutwall from Gothenburg, who is one of the 22 academics in Sweden who have been contesting the Swedish position throughout the whole of this thing. And he and I will be doing an interview for YouTube later in the week. He is ashamed of the Swedish position, of what's happened. We discussed the position about elderly Swedes in care homes who've been dying in large numbers. And it's quite clear that they have been the victim of misguided advice. It was always likely that the epidemic would gather pace in Sweden, and it looks as though that's now been coming to happen. So we take no comfort from the fact that our Swedish friends have been through this and have got it so badly wrong as we ourselves have. And my knowledge of the Scandinavian countries is that when they decide to do something, they will apply themselves to it and hopefully they will retrieve the position. I hope we will retrieve the position, but we seem to be some way off any admission that we've got it wrong. We certainly haven't heard an apology from our government to the folk who are still living in the care homes and to the relatives of those who've died in our care homes. An apology is needed. The Prime Minister should apologise to all the relatives of those who've died in our care homes because of our negligence and our willful failure to protect them. At this stage, 3 months into this pandemic, thanks for listening. Please let us have feedback, add comments, and let us have any questions. And support Double Down News, Patreon, the future of broadcasting, the future of the news. Thank you very much.